So this morning, we're going to look at this whole area of change. Come on, someone shout out change. Okay, come on, someone else shout out change. Can we all shout out change, 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 change? I think when Obama took, one of his things, when he became the president of America, I think he just used the word change. And so this morning, right, you know, it's about change, right? You know, and change is a journey that each one of us just needs to take note, right? Amen. You know, if anything that happens in life, right, it's about change. Amen. And so, you know, this is wonderful scripture we're going to look at shortly. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, which is a fantastic scripture. It's actually an invitation, a special invitation that God gives each one of us. And this special invitation is for a glorious intimacy, right? A special invitation that God gives us for a, I would call it a face-to-face fellowship, right? Come on, lift up your hands this morning. Why? Because I think the biggest problem to change is we ourselves. Amen. You know, we are our biggest stumbling block to ourselves. And, you know, you and I can, you know, of course, right, there's a lot of things that, you know, hinder our change, right? You know, some of us, right, you know, are not willing to change because the work involved. Some of us are not willing to change because, right, you know, we're just maybe pride, stubbornness. You know, some of us are just not willing to change because, you know, we really feel that, you know, things are okay, let's continue. But God's always in this process of, God's always in this process of, of course, the Bible uses a better word, transformation. And, you know, transformation speaks about a change that takes place. And that means, right, you change moving from one step to another and you don't return to your previous step. It's something fresh and new. And so each one of us, right, you know, this morning, you know, it's about you and it's about God. You know, it's a personal transformation that must take place in each one of us. If you're not changing, that means there's something wrong. Amen. That means, right, there's some form of disconnection in our relationship with God and God needs to deal. Amen. You know, if you're not changing, right, you know, in the way that we speak, that means there's something wrong, right? If they're not changing, right, in the way that we think, that means there's something wrong. Amen. If we are not improving, right, in our relationships, in the way that we deal with things, you know, that means, you know, if we're not improving, then we need change. And if we are not changing, that means, right, there's something wrong within each one of us. Amen. And so on the church level as well, right, it's a church transformation. And, you know, and we need to see change, right? Remember our core values, love God, amen, love people, our core values, right? You know, like, you know, empowering people to serve, you know, praying church, leadership, evangelism, lifestyle, power of the Holy Spirit. These are things, right? You know, yes, we have elements, we have this, but we need to see how, right, to enhance it. You know, in change, right, in families as well, right? You know, yes, we may model good relationships, but see how we can do better, right? Amen. And so it is a process. You know, change is not, you know, when the Bible speaks about transformation, it is not like a destination because we will never, never, ever reach the destination wherever God wants us to be as far as becoming, you know, like Christ, right? But we are in this progress. And so our whole journey on earth is a process. And each one of us, right, needs to, you know, as we look at this wonderful scripture, come on, someone tell the person next to you, we're going to look at a wonderful scripture, right? Amen. Every scripture is wonderful, by the way. But this is amazing, right? And it brings forth elements of change and transformation that we need to have. Amen. Let's pray. Lift up your hands to Jesus. Lord, we ask, Father God, even today, you know, I want you just to tell this, Lord, I need to change. Come on, just spend a few moments, say, Lord, I need to change. I need to change. I'm ready for change. I need to change. I need to change, Lord. Lord, there are issues in my life, Lord, that, you know, we need to change, right? That you need to deal with. Not even as a church, right? We need to change, Lord. Lord, we ask, Father God, that even today, God, even this morning, as you look, Lord, at our hearts, Father God, that even, Lord, as we look at our hands lifted up as a sign of our surrender, Lord, as our hands are lifted up, Lord, as a sign of our adoration, but also as a sign of our surrender, our hearts are just wide open, and Jesus, we ask you, oh, through your Spirit, Lord, God, that you will just bring forth a change, Lord. God, that even this morning, Lord, we ask you, God, even, Lord, you know, God, even, Lord, in, you know, to become who you want us to be, to be, Lord, to move where you want us to move, it requires change, Lord. And a lot of times, Lord, we become our own stumbling blocks. And so this morning, Father God, even, Lord, just give us, Lord, a heart, Lord, that's permeable, Lord, a heart, Lord, that's soft. God, that even, Lord, the things of God, that we will hear the voice of God and that we will do, Lord, what you say. We thank you. And Lord Jesus, we give you all the praise. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So change is a journey. It is a process. Amen. And you know, and our whole life on earth is about changing. If we do not change, that means, right, you know, we need to really evaluate our lives. You know, change, right, you know, we need to know that we need to change. Hello? Do we know that we need to change? Okay, second question. Are we willing to change? Do we know? And third question, do we know how to change? And then, right, the most difficult question, are we willing to do what God wants us to do to change? And that's tough, right? And you know, and so, right, you know, these are things that we need to know, right? We need to know that we need to change. You know, if you and I, right, sit in this position, but Pastor, you know, I remember once, right, many years ago, amen, I think in the late 90s, right, and I was at this meeting, right, and then I put this question up about, you know, change, and someone said, I said, you know, we talked about sin, right, and then that one lady said, right, you know, I do not sin. I looked at her and I thought, wow, you know, she's sick, right? Amen. Why? Because, you know, if you and I can make comments to that, and she had some issues in her life. Amen. And so, but if you and I can make comments to that, I don't need to change. That means, right, we are in really, really serious trouble. If you and I are seated here this morning and we say, Pastor, everything's okay, I don't need to change, right? That means, right, we are in really serious trouble. Why? Because our whole process in our Christian life is about change. Amen. About transformation. And so each one of us needs to take note of this. And I'm going to make a statement, a very powerful statement, and you and I need to take note of this, right? Every Christian can change. Wow. Don't give a hand or anything. You know, sometimes, right, I meet people, right, in our Christian, I meet people, right, you know, Pastor, I'm just like this, I cannot change. Pastor, you know, my father had a bad temper. I'm just a bad-tempered person. I cannot change. You know, and these comments, right, are not Christian comments. Amen. Why? Because if you and I, right, are a Christian, amen. You know, if you and I, right, are a Christian, if Jesus dwells in our heart, we have the Holy Spirit in our heart, amen. There is no such thing that we cannot change. The question is whether we are willing to change. Amen. It's not whether, right, you know, we cannot change, whether we are willing to change. That means each one of us, right, we may have character traits. You know, some of us, right, in our DNA, you know, some of us, right, in our environment that we are in, you know, there may be certain things that we have assimilated into our life. But, you know, whatever it is, we have the Spirit of God within us. And because we have the Spirit of God within us, we can change. That means, right, you know, this morning, you know, if you got an issue with your anger, you can change. If you got an issue of just being hard with everybody else, that you can change. Amen. If you've got an issue, right, maybe, right, struggling, you know, about reading the scriptures, you know, we can change. Why? Because we have the Spirit of God within us. And each one of us must understand this. Why? Because, you know, and you and I need to be in a position this morning, right? If not, this message is not going to work. Amen. You and I must be in a position this morning to say, God, I need to change. And I want to change. And I'm willing to change. And I'm willing to do what needs to, what you want me to do to bring forth the change. And so each one of us needs to take note. You know, the Bible uses the word transform. You know, a few scriptures. I think transform is used in three portions in the New Testament. You know, it's used in Romans 12:2. The Bible says, right, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So that's one of the times that the word transform is used. Another time, right, you know, the word is used in a different sense, but really, right, you know, meaning the same thing. When Jesus was transfigured, of course, right, the same Greek word is also transformed. And then, right, this wonderful scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, where the Bible speaks about, you know, the word transform is there. And so, right, you know, when you use the word transform, you know, the Greek word is the same word for metamorphosis. And some of us know that, you know, when you and I studied science, we know the life cycle of a butterfly. So how does a butterfly start? Hello, science teachers. Okay, the butterfly starts with the egg. And then after the egg, what happens? Lava or Another word is, hey, correct me, larva or caterpillar. And then after caterpillar, what happens? It becomes a pupa. There's another scientific word for that, but you know, we will just use the simple word pupa. And after the pupa, it becomes a adult butterfly, right, Christine? Okay, and so this whole word, and you know, in every form that takes place here, right, you know, it's this word transform. You know, can you imagine, right, you know, an egg becoming a caterpillar, and then a caterpillar becoming a pupa? You know, suddenly, right, you know, there is an inner transformation that's taking place, right? And the caterpillar, you know, just doesn't want to change, right? I do not want to become a pupa. I do not want to sit in this thing, right, and just become a pupa. I do not want to become. Does a caterpillar do that? A caterpillar doesn't do that, right? Why? Because ingrained in it, right? You know, God has fashioned it, ingrained. There is an ingrained yieldedness to God, right, to allow this change to take place. There's no resistance. You know, when a pupa becomes an adult butterfly, and that's also a transformation, the word transformation, and there is a change, right, that is going to take place in the pupa's life into an adult butterfly. And that change, right, means, right, it cannot go back to its previous state, right? It's a permanent change. And, you know, and the pupa doesn't kind of decide, right, you know, I'm really comfortable in this, whichever thing I'm in, right? And I do not want to change. But, you know, pupa doesn't say that. Why? Because ingrained within it, right, is an inner yieldedness to the whole process that God has structured for that butterfly, and it becomes, for that butterfly, in the form of pupa, to become an adult butterfly. And so each one of us must understand as well, right, you know, this whole area, right, of change, amen, the whole area that God wants to bring forth change. And this is the word transformation that the scripture uses. And so the scripture, amen, you know, I want you guys to put on the scripture. I want you guys to dream the scripture. I want you guys, right, amen, this morning, right, go back, read the scripture, meditate upon the scripture, use various versions, right, to look at the scripture. But we're going to look at the New King James. The Bible says, but we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of God. Now I'm going to ask you to help me with the scripture. Hey, by the way, you got to help me preach this, you know. Every Sunday, right, anybody comes, you got to help. You want to shout amen, you want to shout, you know, do whatever, you want to clap your hands. But this morning you're going to help me by reading the scripture with me. Hallelujah. Can we do this? Hello? Can we do this? Okay, let's read this together. But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Amen. You know, as I said earlier, right, you know, God is making a special invitation. Do you like invitations? Amen. You know, especially if it's a special invitation, right? You know, we all enjoy a special invitation. And here, right, God is making a special invitation to each one of us. And you know, what's this special invitation for? You know, this special invitation is for, right, a glorious relationship of great intimacy, right? You know, this special invitation, you see, right, there is no one that can satisfy each one of us the way God satisfies, because He created us. You know, when you create something or when you produce something, you know, right, what's best for that something, right? And God created us, right? He knows what's best for us. And so, right, if you and I want to be truly satisfied, come on, church, this morning, right? That's why in Romans 12:2 it says, do not be conformed to this world. Amen. If you and I want to live a life that is in total fulfillment, if you and I this morning, right, want to enjoy, right, every moment of our life, if you and I this morning, right, want to enjoy, right, our workplace, enjoy the people around, if you and I want to, you know, come, you know, church, enjoy the service, man, you know, you and I needs to know, right, that enjoyment and whatever we have, right, is a result of our intimacy with God. That's why, right, this is a spiritual invitation, right, to a glorious intimacy, right? The word glory is used twice here, right? And man, you know, you see right here, the Bible says, right, with unveiled face. You see, right, the Apostle Paul, amen, you know, as you look at the scripture, you know, we look at ourselves, and then, right, we also look at Paul's life as well. You know, before this in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, right? You know, Paul, right, is building a case of the old covenant and new covenant. You know, sometimes, right, you and I, right, you know, we are supposed to be in the new covenant, but we are still behaving like we are in the old covenant, right? You know, the Bible says, right, the old covenant, right, it was a ministry of death. Amen. The new covenant in Christ, right, is the ministry of the Spirit. You know, in the old covenant, it's a ministry of condemnation. In the new covenant, right, it's a ministry of righteousness. In the old covenant, it was a veiled face, right? That means, right, they could not have face-to-face encounter. You know, some of us know in the book of Hebrews, right, that means, right, there was a veil that was put, right? They could not. Why? Because, right, there was sin. And, you know, and the Bible says in Hebrews, right, it was through the blood of Jesus that each one of us, our sins are forgiven, that you and I can enter into God's presence. Through the blood of Jesus, we can, the Bible says, we can boldly enter His presence. And that's why, right, you know, with the old covenant, it was a veiled face. But in the new covenant, because of what Jesus has done for us, through His precious blood, you know, what Jesus has done for us, right, at the cross, dying on the cross, sinless sacrifice, amen, rising again from the dead. Each one of us, right, have an unveiled face. That means, right, what does this mean to you and I? You know, when God uses the word unveiled face, what does it mean? You know, it means, right, that you and I can have a face-to-face encounter. That you and I, right, can have, you know, an intimate, you know, spiritual, intimate relationship with God. That you and I, right, can have this fellowship with God that the Old Testament believers couldn't have. You know, some of them, you know, Moses had a taste of it. But you and I, right, because of what Jesus has done, it is not just, right, for certain people like pastors, prophets, you know, evangelists, whatever. You know, all of us as believers can have, right? Why? Because we have unveiled faces. Every hindrance that was there, that was obstructing us from God, amen, was taken away. So each one of us can have an intimate relationship with God. You see, right, you know, this is the basis, right, of what God wants to do. Why? Because if you and I want to experience change, right, it comes out of an intimate relationship with the Lord. As you look at these words here, another word that's used here, you know, before we look at the word beholding, is the word mirror. Of course, right, you know, I've just been doing, you know, as I prepared this message, right, just doing some, of course, right, you know, people have different interpretations. But what do you use your mirror for? I use the mirror only once a day. And when is that? In the morning when I shave. And that's all, right? I don't use the mirror throughout the day, right? Because I don't need to look at my hairstyle and comb. And I don't need to put lipstick. I don't need to, you know, do all this stuff, right? Which some of you may want to do, right? And so, right, you know, and when you look, when you think of a mirror, there are two things involved, right, when you hear the word mirror. One is, you know, mirror is to be looked, right? When you think of mirror, you got to look, right? You hold the mirror, you know, I've got a mirror. You got to look, right? And so, right, this whole area of look. Another thing, right, when you think of a mirror, what do you think of? Why do you look into a mirror? Because you? Because, okay, another word is evaluate. Of course, I don't think any of you are like one of my friends in school before, right? Every morning coming to school, he will stand before the mirror and he will say, wow, I look so beautiful. Right, I don't think any of you, you know, so the mirror, right, when you mention the word mirror, what does it mean? It means, right, you know, you are there to look. So whenever you think of mirror, you look. When you mention the word mirror, you don't think of cook, right? Don't use the mirror for cooking. You know, you don't use a mirror for anything else, you know, hitting people. Amen. You use the mirror to look. And when you look, right, you know, in a mirror, you're evaluating. And so, right, you know, here, right, you know, the Bible says this, right? Beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord. You see, friends, this morning, right, you know, change takes place. Come on, someone say change. Come on, some treat. Someone say change, change, change. Come on, someone say I need to change. And come on, someone say I'm ready for change, right? Amen. And you know, see, right, if you and I want to see this change, amen, it is about beholding Christ, right? The Bible says, beholding as in a mirror, looking, right, at the glory of the Lord, right? Amen. Looking, right, you know, beholding Christ. And each one of us must know, right, this, right, is the essence of for us to be changed. You know, look at, you know, a lot of the scriptures, right? You know, familiar scriptures. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. The Bible, you know, Jesus, you know the scripture, the writer of Hebrews says, right, you know, when you run, right, run with endurance. Don't look, you know, there are witnesses surrounding you. You know, lay aside every weight. And then he says, right, look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. Look, right. You see, right, you know, this whole beholding is not just look and it's a contemplation, right. This whole beholding, right, it's a look, right. This whole beholding, right, you know, speaks about, right, you know, looking, fellowship, you know, it speaks about communion. It speaks about you and I, right, you know, simple, right, just spending time with Jesus, each one of us. You know, we just need to spend time with Jesus. Amen. You know, you and I, right, need to not just have time with Jesus, but a life with Jesus. You know, as Paul said, right, in one of the, in Philippians 1:21, you know, he said, right, you know, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain, gain Christ. And so everything in life, right, is about Christ. That means, right, you know, I've come to church, it's about Christ. You know, when I the service finished, right, you know, it's about Christ, right? We are here to behold Christ. You know what's the problem that's happened these days, right? You know, people have become so self-sensitive that we are insensitive of God's presence. You know, we have become, right, you know, so self-sensitive in ourselves, right, that we have been insensitive of God's presence. Amen. Insensitive of what God wants. You know, we have become so preoccupied with self, amen, that we forget, right, to think, right, or ask ourselves, right, what does Jesus think about this? You know, we always seem to, you know, look at things, evaluate, judge. But, you know, we can, you know, judge worship or whatever, right? But we forget to remember, right, we are here to express worship. You know, we are here, right, you know, service finished, you know, whatever, right? We are here, right, you know, that should be done this way, that should have been done this way, right? But we forget to ask ourselves this question, right? What does God think of me? You know, we are here, right, you know, we have got into this whole thing about, you know, was I blessed? You know, if we go for a meeting, was I blessed, right? Was it, we forget to go into the next phase, right? Could I be a blessing? Or how could I be a blessing? And so, right, you know, each one of us, right, you know, we have gotten to this mode that, you know, it's a self-preoccupation and not a God preoccupation, right? And subtly, right, the enemy has distracted us through circumstances, through the environment, right, that we have become so self-focused that we have really, right, you know, kind of neglected this whole area of beholding Jesus. Jesus himself said, right, you know, the things that I do because what I see the Father do. You see, right, he was beholding the Father. You know, when Jesus said, right, in John 15, you know, amazing chapter of basic Christian foundations, when Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches, he who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for apart from me you can do nothing. Again, right, you know, it speaks about how we need to abide. What is abide? Abide means we need to stay, right? You know, what, you know, we need to abide with Jesus. You know, abide means, right, we make our abode. Abide means, right, we live, you know. That means, right, this whole area of beholding. Church, this morning, right, you know, God wants to bring change. You know, we want to change, right? I need to change. You know, I'm 60 years old. Amen. I'm just a kid to Uncle Samuel. Right, Uncle Samuel? I'm just a kid to you, right? Amen. But, you know, there is a change that needs to take place. Amen. You know, each one of us, you know, and, you know, as long as we are in this physical body, we need to change. And so when you and I behold Jesus, that means, right, our focus in life, right, must be to look to Jesus. That means, come on, church, you know, it involves, right, you know, the way that we spend time. It involves, right, in every area of our life. Amen. It is a lifestyle of beholding Jesus. Because, you know, mirror, remember what the word mirror involves? Look. When you think of mirror, you got to look, right? You know, if you don't think of a mirror, you know, a mirror, right, you got to look. But not just that, right? When you think of mirror, like you look, what is the looking for? Looking is evaluate. And so this whole building, you know, beholding Jesus involves, right, not just being with him, right, but becoming more of him. And, you know, as a result of that, right, you know, he becomes, like, you know, he begins to reveal things in our life. That means, right, you know, church, you know, we are beholding Jesus. We need to think, right, you know, we need to think more like the way Jesus would think. When we are beholding Jesus, that means, right, we need to speak the way, you know, Jesus would speak. You know, when we are beholding Jesus, remember our theme for this year is imparting love, impacting lives. That's our church vision. That means that we need to love the way that Jesus, you know, would love. You know, and we think, you know, when we behold Jesus, that means that we need to impact lives, right, the way Jesus impacted. Amen. And so, right, you know, and so this is a process that needs to take place. And this process takes place by us beholding. Church, you know, there is no, right, you know, there is no way for each one of us to change, right, apart from the changer, Jesus, right. There is no way, right, for us, right, to experience, right, things in our life. You know, come on, some of us, right, came up from non-Christian backgrounds. Some of us came up from Christian backgrounds. You know, we are believers, right? Some of us, right, have experienced breakthroughs in our life. Some of us, right, you know, some of you, some me, myself, right, you know, habits, right, that were impossible to be set free, Jesus set us free, right? Can I hear an amen? Amen. You know, thought patterns, right, things, right, you know, there are things, right, that we do now, you know, that we did before that we will not do now. There are thought patterns that we've had before that we will not have now. Why? Because there's a process of change that's taking place. And God wants to lead us on. Amen. You see, right, you know, the Bible says, right, beholding as a mirror the glory of the Lord, we are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory. Come on, tell the person next to you, from glory to glory. You know, what does this mean, right? That means, right, you know, it's in a process from glory to glory, right? You know, it's not like our change, you know, sometimes we think, right, change, right, from backsliding to glory. You know, sometimes, right, we think of our change, right, from bad to good. Yes, you know, bad to good is change. But for us, right, you know, our change, right, involves, right, good to better. You know, from glory to glory, right? You know, from one glorious situation to another position of greater glory. Amen. You know, and so, right, this whole change, right, if you are good, right, you know, we want to see become better, right? You know, of course, right, we will never be like the best, amen, because the best is like Christ, amen, but it is the progression that each one of us takes, right, to become like Christ, amen. And so, right, this whole area of beholding Him, we are being transformed into the same image, right? Come on, church, you know, people need to look at us and they need to say, wow, these guys are different. They really remind me of Jesus. Amen. You see, right, you know, then, right, you know, our whole life becomes different. You know, we, right, you know, portray Jesus, we become more like Jesus. And when you and I become more like Jesus, what happens, right? This is the process of transformation. You know, of course, right, you know, Bible uses some words like sanctification, holiness. You know, it's being, we're separated from the world. Amen. There is a subtraction and there's an addition. Amen. There is a putting off and there's a putting on. And you and I become more like Christ. And we need to be more like Christ. Our goal in life, amen. You know, we may have many goals, right? You know, as a church, right, we have, right, you know, our vision, imparting love, impacting lives. We've got, right, a prophetic destiny, church of thousands. Amen. There are a lot of things, right, our core values. You know, you may have, you know, as individuals, you may have your goals. You may have goals, right, you know, your life, right. You know, if you're studying, you may have goals. Amen. You want to achieve a certain level. Amen. You may be in, you know, studying your workplace. You may have certain goals. Amen. You may be about to get married. You may have certain goals. We have kids, right. We may have certain goals. We have grandkids. We may have certain goals. But you see, right, the goal above every goal, come on church, listen to me, the goal, every goal is this, right, that we must be transformed in this image, right? Amen. That means, right, you know, whatever, you know, we cannot be so preoccupied with ourselves, we cannot be so concerned about me, amen. And, you know, we forget that our whole goal in life is to be like Christ. And, you know, and for that to take place, the process of change that takes place is that we need to behold Him. Are you hearing me this morning? We need to behold Him. That means, right, come on, each one of us needs to make a conscious effort, right? Because we are beholding a lot of other stuff, right? We are beholding a lot of us, right? You know, all of us, right, we are bold in some sense beholding ourselves, right? Why? Because our self is important. Preoccupied with ourself, right? Preoccupied, right, you know, about me being blessed, right? Preoccupied about, you know, what do I want, right? You know, preoccupied by, you know, what do I feel like, right? And not what God feels like, right? Preoccupied, right, what's this, right? We look at situations, and then, right, you know, come on, church, we look at situations with the perspective of Jesus. There must be a perspective change in our minds. And for that to take place, transformation. And so our goal, right? Doesn't matter what we're doing, right? Amen. You may be a film producer. Amen. You may be a teacher. You know, you may be doing a lot of different things. You know, some of you may be consultants. Some of us in full-time ministry. But our goal is to be conformed to His image from glory to glory. What does the scripture say, right? Amazing, right? Amazing portion of scripture. Come on, tell the person next to you what an amazing portion of scripture. Spiritual intimacy, right? Amen. Change. Amen. You know what? Change. Just as by the Spirit of the Lord. So who is the Spirit of Transformation? Hello? Talk to me. Who is the Spirit of Transformation? The Holy Spirit, right? He dwells within us. And you know, each one of us, right? You know, going back to the illustration of the butterfly, right? Say the caterpillar becoming a pupa. There's something ingrained within it that brings an inner transformation, right? Something ingrained, right? You know, something, right, that God put within, you know, within their fiber of their being, right? For inner transformation, right? And the pupa just allows it to happen. Or the caterpillar just allows that transformation to happen. You see, as believers, right, we have got someone within us, the Spirit of Transformation, the Holy Spirit. You can also call Him Transformer. Hello? The Transformer dwells in you. The Transformer is within you, right? And what does the Transformer do? The Transformer, right, His desires is that you become conformed to His image, right? And what do we need to do, right? We just need to allow it. That means, right, this morning, right, you know, you need to allow, you need to behold. You need, right, to make an effort, right, you know, but you also this morning, right, you need to allow the Transformer, amen, the Holy Spirit, the Transformer within each one of us, amen, to allow us, right, to be transformed. And how does He transform us? He transforms us, right, so that we can become more like Jesus in His image. You see, right, you know, and so, right, you know, Christian life, you see, right, there is a driver within us that enables us. Amen. You know, there is the Spirit of God within us, right, that drives us, that leads us. And you and I, right, are trying to operate on natural effort. Amen. You know, you and I are trying to do things, overcome things with our natural thinking. You know, yes, you know, we need to exercise wisdom. We need to exercise this. God's given us a mind to think. But you also, right, have a Transformer within each one of us, right, that dwells within us. And His name is the Spirit of the Lord that will enable you, right, to bring change. So begin, right, to allow that to take place. That means, right, you know, that means the issues, amen, within our life, right? You see, it's a continuous journey. And you need to allow, right? If there are things in our life, right, that, you know, we are struggling with, maybe certain individuals, or maybe, right, the way that we react. Of course, right, you know, all of us in some sense, right, have this problem of over-worrying. Amen. That means, right, our minds are filled with fruitless activity that does not bring fruit. You know, I think someone said, right, only 5% of your worries are worth worrying, right? All the others are all nonsense, you know? And we spend so much of energy, right? We spend so much of things, right? You know, thinking of things, right, that we are maybe, you know, we are not in control of. And so, right, each one of us, you know, bring us the Spirit of God to help us. Why? The Spirit of God is there. And the Spirit of God, right, you know, His job, right, is to make us conform to His image. And how does He do it, right? That's why another scripture, Romans 12:2, right? The Bible says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And so what the Spirit of God does is the Spirit of God, right, will never, it will always cooperate with us, right? He will never do something against our will. And so you need to cooperate and you need to allow. And here the Bible says, right, you know, how does God bring this change is by the renewing of our mind. You see, right, God has given us the keys and God has given us the enablement for this and we need to allow, right? And this whole area, amen, of renewing our mind. You know, in Ephesians 4, go back, take note of this, verses 22 to 24, right? It speaks of how, right, there must be an addition we need to put on. And, you know, and so, right, you know, our whole aid, the Spirit of God will enable us, quicken us, right? And we need to make a decision to allow our minds to be renewed. That means, right, we need to get, come on church, we need to get the word in. We need to put on some really good thoughts. Amen. And we need to begin to reject, right, some of the negative stuff that we are so programmed. You know, all of us are so programmed, right? You know, backgrounds, right? And all these things, right? Rejection, you know, rejection, one of the biggest devils, right? A lot of people make decisions out of rejection. Amen. And you know, and here, right, you know, we are so programmed to think so negatively that we do not put on the Word of God and think the way the Spirit of God wants us to think. Church, this morning, right, it's about change, right? And, you know, and this change takes place, right? You see, change is something that God wants to bring. Amen. Change is something, right, that all of us can change. Change is a process. You know, change is something that you and I need to behold Jesus. That means, right, you know, for us to change, you need to change, I need to change, all of us need to change. You got problem, I got problem, all of us have got areas of weakness. We need to identify, we need to come, behold Jesus. And as we begin to behold Jesus, you know, we look into our lives and see areas that He needs to change. And then, right, we allow Him, we yield to Him. If we need to confess, we confess. We yield the Holy Spirit, the transformer within us. We just yield. And step by step, right, you know, we begin to deal, right, with our thought life. And as a result of that, what happens, right, is there is change that takes place, right? And there must be change. You see, the Bible says here, right, do not be conformed to this world. There are things that we need to do, right? You know, sometimes, right, we are so preoccupied with ourselves and the world, right? If we forget, right, about the transformation, the renewing of our mind. And you see, right, when transformation takes place or when godly change takes place, what happens? The result is, there's always a reward, right? You see, everything that God does, right, there's always a good end. That's what movies, you know, I always watch movies that have good ends. You know, and so that everything that God does, right, there's always a good end. And, you know, and that good end is that you may prove or experience, right, the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Change, right? You know, Apostle Paul, get the worship team up. You know, Apostle Paul, look at his life, right? You know, he had an amazing encounter on the road to Damascus. But, you know, as you look at, you know, the book of Acts and in his journey in life, amen, you see, right, it was not just he wrote this by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, but he also lived it, right? Amen. Can you just imagine him, right, at, you know, in Philippi, in that prison. Amen. You know, what is he doing there, right? You know, in prison, you know, wrongly put in prison for a good thing that he did, right? He was witnessing. And there he was just worshipping the Lord, right? What song do we sing, right, when we are going through experiencing tremendous pressure? Sing a song, right? I mean, quote a scripture. And even then, right, you see the change that takes place, right? Even when the prison break came. You know what, you know, most of us, right, would have bolted out and run for good life, right? But you see, right, you know, for him, it was a higher issue, right? He was beholding Christ. And you know, what did Christ want of me? Yes, you know, God has allowed this prison break. And there was that jailer that needed to be saved, right? And as a result, that jailers get saved and a great church in Philippi started, right? And this was the first time, right? This whole journey into Philippi, first time, right, the church was planted in Europe, right? You see, friends, this morning, right, you know, all God is looking for yielded vessels this morning, right? You know, I want to challenge each one of us. Come on, tell the person next to you, change, 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 change. Come on, tell the person next to you, you need to change. Hello, talk to me, you need to change. Tell the person next to you, you need to change. I need to change. We need to change. Okay, our vision, imparting love, impacting lives. Well, how can we bring a change in that? You see, right, if you and I behold Christ, what happens, right? Jesus said, right, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. Then we become that, right? Jesus said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Follow him, I become fisher of men. Don't follow him, how can I become a fisher of men? And so the key is beholding him, right? And so this morning, right, you know, I just want to challenge you guys, right? You know, be who Jesus wants you to be. Amen. Don't be, right, you know, who people want you to be. Be who Jesus wants you to be, right? Hello? You are the best at being yourself. All of you have got different skills. You know, look at Adeline, different skill. Look at President, different skill sets. You know, all of us are different. Auntie is so different. And all of us have got different needs. You know, Uncle Samuel, 84 years old. Sit down, talk to him, right? If he gets your name in, he'll be praying for you every day. You know? You know? And you know, and you know, all of us have got different skill sets. All be who Christ wants you to be. and be the person that, and allow Him to change us. Stand up with me.